I actually had no interest in geology until I arrived here 14 years ago.
Now, can you see little plants growing immediately in front of you? You can see little stalks coming out of the ground, pale cream, with little flower heads on them.
The cream one down here.
They're moving about.
Yeah.
That's bog aspinall.
I started my career as a tour guide. I have no qualifications or anything like that. I was inquisitive, I wanted to know more about them, so I just bought loads and loads of books. The troubles were really, really intense when I was a police officer. People were very polarised. Communities didn't actually interact with each other. And I've noticed since the geopark was established and the global geopark now that people seem to be more comfortable with each other's cultures. And that can only be a good thing for the future and for the future of the children as well. I can see that more so in the young people. Well, I can look out and I can see going back thousands of years, if not millions of years. Up around here is so unique, even the plants are unique. Some of the plants here have been on the go since the last ice age, and some people find that hard to believe. And that's why we have the geopark, we have an area, so many areas of special scientific interest, because these plants live in these small colonies. I believe the land made the people and the people made the land. And that's how it's inextricably connected with each other. And you can see it even in folklore and superstition. You can even hear today in different meanings and terms that are spoken unknownst to some people that's been passed down over the years.
A geopark to me is an area that's got really exceptional rocks and landscapes. So they must be internationally important. And that means that they have to have had some significant impact on geological history and geological heritage in general. But it's not good enough just to have really good rocks and landscapes. The area has to be protected, and it also has to be used for education and also for sustainable development. At Marble Arch Caves, every year we organise Science Week, and the whole point of Science Week is to bring children together from both County Cavan and County Fermanagh to try and engage in some shared learning, to learn about their shared heritage, their shared geological landscapes, and to learn a little bit about science at the same time.
Welcome to Marble Arch Caves, UNESCO Global Geopark. My name is Ian.
Hi.
How you doing? So we're going to do wee experiments today.
Okay, who wants to make a volcano?
Me!
Aliens don't seem that enthusiastic.
Me!
Well, it's unpredictable. I don't know how many it takes. It's like earthquakes are unpredictable.
I think to date we have had maybe around about 4,000 school pupils that have taken part in these activities, so it's been something that's really successful.
Right, the joints go down and the bedding planes go across. So, what do you call this one going down?
Joints, bedding planes.
So, what do you think the giant's causeway is? What's
I don't
volcano?
Want
to be is it active, extinct, or dormant?
Extinct.
I think so.
So the Marble Arch Caves UNESCO Global Geopark is a cross-border geopark. Part of it is in County Fermanagh in Northern Ireland, which is part of the UK, and the other part is in County Cavan, which is part of the Republic of Ireland. At the centre of the geopark is the Marble Arch Caves. That's where it gets its name from.
All the formations you're going to see in the caves are formed from calcium carbonate or calcite.
In Irish, water is an important word, because the word for whiskey in Irish is Ishkabaha, which means water of life. It's often I've done a tour in the morning and I went to do a shift in the bar at night and seen the same people I had on my tour, and you know, you probably get a bit more out of them when they're in the pub, but it's the same response all the time, that oh, we love the tour and didn't know what was down here, and I'd never been before and it was great, and oh, I definitely recommend it and I'll go back. And even that's nice, you know, that's a nice sensation too, that you do feel like you're showing people probably the heart of the county, like, you know, you're showing them something very special down here. The Marble Arch Cave story is quite special in the fact that it was extreme cutting of turf on Kulka Mountain, which led to this cave being flooded more, and the people decided, well, we're going to try and conserve the environment and protect the bogland. So we had to first thing we had to do was restore the bog, heather bog itself, so to put the soil and the ground back into the ground, if that makes sense.
I grew up just outside Belfast. I grew up in the height of the Troubles. So to come along to a cross-border geopark and see that people are coming together to share their differences and their similarities and to really understand and appreciate each other, I think for me that is very rewarding.
My father used to bring me to a little lake that's over there. It's full of perch. This landscape has inspired me, I suppose, since I've been a child. I just felt the whole story hadn't been told. And with a friend of mine, Gaby Burns, we started surveying this landscape. Here, bit by bit, a complete prehistoric world has revealed itself to me. And it's still going on revealing itself. And it's absolutely just wonderful to be able to connect with that.
Now, you look carefully at that, you'll think that when you come back in a fortnight's time, that would have collapsed. I'm suggesting to you, it's at least 5,000 years there. This is what we have found all over the place in the burn area of County Cavan. We don't just have the regularly built megalithic monuments. We have these modified glacial erratics that have been propped up, that have been worked on.
Gives you a much broader perspective on the world and on history than let's say, out in the busy world of a modern city or something like that. The prehistoric world is so close, the people seem to be so close. We can imagine them going about their daily lives, they're looking after their animals, planting their crops, living, loving and dying, as I said. And we're reaching a much larger audience now. We're getting the message out, and people are beginning to appreciate what a wonderful place, what a wonderful world, what a wonderful lost world this area, this landscape represents.
I had the pleasure of going to Iran last summer because I am one of the evaluators for the UNESCO Global Geopark. So I was sent to assess an applicant geopark from Keshem Island in the south of Iran. One of the delights for me to go there was to realise that yes, we are a very, very different country, but we also have very strong similarities in that we all cherish our heritage and we all really want to see our landscape being promoted to the wider world. Regardless of what I say about the essential criteria, those essential criteria are nothing without the people that live in a geopark. And without their passion, without their enthusiasm, geoparks really can't thrive and they can't flourish. And that's what's happened at Marble Arch with people like Ian and with people like Chris and with people like Jim. And we have the same in Iran and we have the same all over the world, and really that's what makes them so successful. Is that waffly? That probably is waffly.
No, that's waffly.
That's waffly.
No, that was amazing.